Welcome to Evangelistic Outreach Ministries.
The fields are white, all ready to harvest.
For over half a century, the Evangelistic Outreach team has traveled across the street, about the nation, and around the world with the gospel message. We're dedicated to the vision of our late founder, Dr. Calvin Evans, to reach the unreached for Jesus Christ. May the love of Christ touch you, and may His Word teach you today on Evangelistic Outreach.
John chapter 19. If you found John chapter 19, say amen.
Amen.
All right, now go with me to verse 17. 17. If you found that, say amen.
Amen.
And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. We want to preach tonight on the subject, the man in the middle. The man in the middle. You may be seated tonight. And when I call him a man, you understand I'm not demeaning Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I believe it was Timothy that said, there's one mediator between God and man, that's the man, Christ Jesus. All these kids nowadays says, you're the man, you're the man. Well, I know who the man is, and his name is Jesus Christ. So when I say that, I'm not demeaning him in any way. But he is the man in the middle. And it seems like every day, and in my introduction tonight, I kind of reflected this. We are getting ourselves caught in the middle of some awful things. Many of you tonight are in the middle of messes at your house, at your workplace, in your own soul. We're caught in the middle of some big messes nationally. We have, just came through a political season, God only knows what has been thrown around during those times, and we know how ugly those things can get. But even in our world, we have global chaos. We have riots going on all over the world, not only in our country. We have instability in the Mideast, and who knows where else that we don't even know about even yet to see. We don't know what's going on even right now across the world that people are in the middle of. And really, if we bring it down on our level, we don't know what we'll be in the middle of tomorrow. You don't know what one phone call may change your life forever. I've been in circumstances where I've gotten a phone call in the middle of the night and your heart goes to your throat and you're thinking, my, oh my, what has happened? And on the other end has been some distress or some bad news that has changed my life forever. Many of you have maybe been in that spot. Who knew that the Tuesday after Christmas that Calvin Ray and his wife Candy would be in the middle of a huge medical crisis? And then even a week after that, 3 weeks ago yesterday, I took my son to Children's Hospital to get an appendix taken out. It's minuscule compared to some things, but right then and there, I was in the middle of a mess and I needed help. So we get ourselves caught in the middle of some big things. But aren't you glad that there is a man in the middle with us, and his name is Jesus? Yes, he is everywhere, but I am thankful that he is right here. He's in the middle of every mess that I get into, and he's in the middle of your problem tonight. He's in the midst of them, and thank God he will be there with you. The old songwriter says, he's in the midst of our storm. He's in the valley we walk through. Where two or three are gathered in his name, he'll be there too. When you feel so all alone, and he's standing next to you, he's with us now, oh my Lord, he's in the midst. Now those words, in the midst, that we read to you in our text, they're actually found 249 different times in Scripture. And with God's help, I'm going to preach on all 249 of those tonight. Okay, I may go ahead and do that. That would be fine. I'm kidding. I want to deal just a few places where we find those words in the midst, and I guarantee someone is going through this type of situation in your life. First of all, Jesus is the man in the middle. He is in the midst of our fiery furnaces. The Bible says in the book of Daniel, he answered and said, lo, this is King Nebuchadnezzar talking. He answered and said, lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Well, I have news for King Nebuchadnezzar. It wasn't like the Son of God. It was the Son of God walking in the midst of the fiery furnace with the three Hebrew children. You all know that story. I won't go into it very briefly. Let me just say a few things. It's good that in the midst of our fiery furnaces, whatever we go through, Jesus is walking in the middle of it with us. Do you know that these boys, they were thrown into the fire, but first of all, because they were persecuted. They were persecuted. They were persecuted because of their standards. They refused to bow to the idol. They refuse to bow to the king's idol. Now, that's a word we don't hear a lot today, and I may get closed off right now by half of you, but I just want to go on record and say it's okay to have standards. And in fact, it's biblical to have standards. There are things that after we're saved, we shouldn't do anymore. Amen. And listen, and we are going to be persecuted because of our standards. I remember years ago, people would do certain things or not do certain things, and here's what they say, because God told me so, and he told me not to do this or told me not to do that. And so many times we don't hear those testimonies anymore, and that's because I believe people think that they'll get made fun of and persecuted. But may I submit to you, if you're doing it in the name of the Lord and you're doing it for the glory of God, by all means, keep your standards, do what God has called you to do, and give glory and worship to him. But they were persecuted because of their standards. They were persecuted because of their Savior. King Nebuchadnezzar wanted to be put in the top place, but they said, no, you're not going to get there. We only have one God, and his name is Jehovah. And they refused to bow because of their Savior. But then they were persecuted because of their stance. They stood when others wouldn't stand. There was probably thousands of people there that day when the king gave the order and the decree to blow the trumpet and to play the music. And when they played all those instruments, he said, you must bow to the idol. But out in the midst of those thousands of people, as they were bowing their heads and bowing their knees to that idol, here stood three young men, boldly and upright. And they stood when nobody else would stand. There's no coincidence that Jared gave you that phone number before I preached. Why? Because that's telling the world, telling the state of Kentucky, that we are taking a stand. We want prayer back in school. And this election should have told us, but all of us this, that if people will take a stand and people will do what's right, God will have his way. Hey, listen, I'm telling you, it's time. We as Christians, we've been way too silent when it comes to the things of the world. And when it comes to God's ways, it's time for us to take a stand and boldly, unashamedly say, I am a Christian. And it doesn't matter what anybody else will say. I guarantee that Madonna doesn't speak for all you women out there tonight. Or Ashley Judd, even though she's a native Kentuckian. I guarantee that. But see, those liberal idiots are taking a stand. And what are we doing? Well, we'll pray for them. It's time for us to take a stand. We do have a voice, and we have the backing of the Holy Spirit. We don't do it in a mean way. We don't do it rioting. We don't mess things up like the liberals do. No, what we do is we stand on the word of God. And when we stand, listen, you will be persecuted. But listen, you have to know that when you stand, God is standing right there next to you. Somebody say amen tonight. I'm busy preaching. I'm glad that even though we're persecuted, Jesus is standing with us. They were persecuted, but they were protected in the midst of the fire. Nebuchadnezzar and the others were amazed. They looked inside, and our text that I read to you said they were loose, walking around in the midst of the fire. They were free in the fire. They were free. When they went into the fire, what did it say? They bound them, didn't they? But it specifically said, I see four men loose, walking around in the the midst of the fire. What does that tell us? That tells us the only thing that was burnt inside the fire was what had them bound. And that gives us great assurance tonight that yes, we may go through the fiery furnaces, but sometime God sends us in there and says, yeah, I'll walk around with you, but there are some things that need burnt off of you. And listen tonight, if you're bound by the things of the past, if you're bound by the guilt of the past, if you're bound by the chains that you've made of your own affliction, listen tonight, thank God when you go through that fiery furnace and Jesus walks with you, it'll set you free and he'll burn the things off that are binding you tonight. In fact, they were freer in the fire than they were out of the fire, because they were protected. God was there with them. And you notice that not only were they free in the fire, but they were fine in the fire. The Bible tells us not only were they loose walking around, but they were unhurt. They weren't burnt. Not even the smell of smoke on them. Not one hair or one piece of their clothes were singed. That's a miracle. And when Nebuchadnezzar saw the four men, he specifically said four men. We know three went in, and then three came out. And you might say, well, where'd the fourth man at? The songwriter said, he's still in the fire. What's that tell us tonight? That tells us just like the Hebrew children, we may go through a fiery furnace and we may go through a fiery trial. It may be tomorrow. It may be next week. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. But I've got assurance tonight. Thank God that my Jesus Christ will be there with me, walking around in the midst of that fiery furnace with me. Why? Because he's still in the fire. He's in the middle of our fiery furnace. Secondly, tonight he's in the middle of our stormy seas. Mark chapter 6, familiar passage says this, and when even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And he saw them toiling in rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, the darkest part of night, he cometh unto them walking upon the sea, and would have passed them by. If you read this entire story, you'll find out a few things about this. First of all, he sent them. If you read at the very beginning of this story, he constrained them, the Bible says, to get into the ship. That literally means, if you look at it in the original Greek, that means he put them in the boat, he pushed his foot on the boat, and pushed it out into the sea. He wasn't saying, boys, I want to be alone. He was saying, boys, I'm going to send you out into the storm. You say, you mean God would send me into a storm? Yeah. He either sends you or he allows it to happen. But either way, he sent them. There was no storm around. There was no storm clouds around. If you study that area of the Sea of Galilee, you'll find the storms can pop up just like that. There was no storm going on. But he still sent them knowing that there would be a storm up ahead. What does that tell us tonight? That tells us that sometimes he allows storms and sometimes he knows what's up ahead, but yet he still says, go. And you say, Brian, that's awful. No, 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 no. That tells me that everything that comes to me has to go through him, and he's still in control. Everything that happens in life, listen, is not of the devil. But everything is Father filtered. And he knows what's best for us, and he's in the middle of our stormy seas. Not only did he send them, but he saw them. He saw them. He was alone on the land praying. But it says he saw them toiling and rowing. You say, well, Brian, they were just down there in the sea. No, you don't understand. I read to you they were in the midst of the sea. The Sea of Galilee was over 7 miles long. If they were in the midst of the sea, what's the midst mean? The middle. If they were in the middle of the sea, they were probably 3 to 3.5 miles away from Jesus at the time. But yet it says he saw them. Well, maybe on a clear and sunny day, that would have been possible with human eyes. But no, you don't. This was the fourth watch of the night. They were in the middle of a storm, in the middle of the sea, and yet Jesus still saw them. What us tonight. That should give you great assurance. Some of you are right in the middle of the greatest sea and the greatest storm of your life. But thank God, don't you think for 1 minute that you are alone in this thing. You may be toiling and rowing. You may be trying to get out of it yourself. But I've got great news for you. Jesus sees you. He sees you. He's praying for you. And just when you need him, hallelujah, he'll come walking on the water and come out to you and not only send you and see you, but he will save you. That's what he did to them. He saved them. He just didn't observe them from a distance. He came to where they were at and saved them. That's great assurance, isn't it, folks? Some of you may not be going through something tonight. And you may be, well, that's fine, Brian. I want you to move on to the next point. But there are some people that's going through some massive storms in their life. But listen, if you're not going through one right now, you may be going through one tomorrow. But let me reassure you, you are not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone. You may think there's nobody listening or nobody watching, but thank God Jesus sees you. Jesus cares for you, and he won't leave you alone. He'll come walking on the sea to where you are at. The thing that feared them, they were afraid of that sea. They were experienced fishermen, but you can tell they were scared to death. But thank God Jesus used their fear as a vehicle to get to where they were at and was able to save. The Bible says he would have passed them by. The old songwriter says the things that are over your head, they are under his feet. Aren't you glad tonight that he is the sea walker and he is the peace speaker? He's in the midst of our stormy seas. And he said, when he got to them and they were scared, they thought he was a ghost. He said, it is I, be not afraid. What great words. Yeah, I'll try to move on, but years ago I was doing a study on storms and preaching messages on storms, and I got to researching about hurricanes. And if you've ever studied hurricane or if you watch the Weather Channel, then you know that a hurricane has an eye in the middle of the storm. And that hurricane is, even though how massive the winds are and how violent the winds and the rains are, in the middle of a hurricane, where the eye is at, there is perfect peace. Right in the middle of that storm, there is perfect peace. In fact, if you were dumb enough to sit there through a hurricane and the eye passed over you, you could see directly through the hurricane because there's perfect peace in the eye of a storm. The most fiercest part of the hurricane is right around the eye, but in the middle of it, in the center, there's perfect peace. No wonder Jesus said, it is I. Be not afraid. Why? Because he's the eye of the storm. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of a war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. Aren't you thankful for that tonight? He's in the midst of our stormy seas. I'll move on hurriedly. Thirdly, you'll notice he's in the midst of Calvary's cross. That's what I read to you tonight. It says where they crucified him and two others with him on either side, one, and Jesus in the midst. I read that if you were crucified in the middle, that means you were the most guilty of punishment. And here the most innocent, perfect person that ever walked the face of the earth was hanging in the middle. In the middle of two thieves, but he was hanging in the middle of some more people that day. He was crucified in the midst of ruthless men, soldiers that beat on him, spit on him, pulled the beard out of his flesh, made mockery of him. He was crucified in the middle of them. He was not only crucified with them, but he was crucified in the midst of religious men, chief priests and scribes that broke every kind of law to make sure that he would die. They were there. The ruling men, Pilate and Herod, were guilty of ignoring what they knew to be true about Jesus. For if Pilate himself said, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. He was crucified in the midst of rebellious men, He was in the middle of two thieves. And in fact, if you read your Bible closely in Luke 23:39, they both railed on him and rejected him vocally. Riotous men he was crucified in the middle of. The same people that were waving palm branches and crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord," were now shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." Can you imagine the pain that he suffered that day in the midst? Crucifixion was known as the most horrible form of execution ever invented by men. When a person was nailed to a cross, these weren't roofing nails. These were long, if you can imagine, railroad spikes would be the closest thing that would compare. Most people believe that, some people believe rather, that he was crucified in his hands, but if you would study it closely, it was actually in the wrist, because they called this whole part the hand in the Bible. And so they would put the nail right in here below the palm, and if you feel your hand, there's some nerves in there and bones, and they would place it right there and drive it into the wood. What that would do, there's a nerve that runs through your arm called the median nerve. That would strike that nerve, and when it strikes the nerve, it sends your body into convulsions and spasms, uncontrollable. And when they would do that, your body would jerk and spasm and beat against the cross. Then he would cross the feet and take a longer spike and drive it through the top of the feet and nail both those feet. Sometimes they would even turn them to the side and drive it through the ankle. And then, if that wasn't bad enough, they would hoist the cross up and place it in a hole, and the whole body weight would come down on those nails. Body spasming, trying to get breath. And what would happen is, as their legs were crossed and as their hands were outstretched, they would have trouble breathing, and their body would sag under the weight and the dehydration and the blood loss. And so the only way they could get relief is they would hoist themselves up with their feet, trying just to take another breath. That's why you'll find that they were coming to break their legs, because men that were maybe more physically well built would last for days, and they would come and break their legs so they would not be able to put pressure on them, so they would die. Ultimately, people would die by suffocation because of the pressure that was there. Jesus not only had the weight of his own flesh on his shoulders that day, but the weight of the sin of the world. And you know why he did that? He loved you. Scott Porter, he loved you. Sherry, he loved you. Ashley, he loved you. Kenny, he loved you. He loved you. That's why he did it. Every breath he took, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He loved you. And then he said, "Tetelestai." He took one last breath and said, "Tetelestai." You say, what's that word? King James Bible says, "It is finished." Because yes, he suffered pain, but there was a purpose behind it. And the purpose was to pay the sin debt for all mankind. That's why he said "Tetelestai," because not only was it used on the cross that day, but it would have been familiar to everyone standing around. Because in that day and age, when a servant was finishing a task, and when the servant completed it, whether it be cleaning a house or just making something, they would stand back and say, "Tetelestai, it is finished." When a priest would have a sacrificial animal and examine it, and it was found worthy to be perfect and spotless without blemish, the priest would hold the lamb up and say, "Tetelestai, it is finished." When a farmer had an animal that was born a perfect specimen, they would say, tetelestai, it is finished. When an artist had applied the last brushstroke on the canvas or making a piece of pottery and they were done, they would step back and look at that work and say, tetelestai, it is complete, it is finished. And when people would go out into the streets and purchase things, they would haggle over a price. And when the price was settled on, and when the price had been paid, the merchant would say, tetelestai, it is finished. So it's no wonder that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, hanging between heaven and earth, would say, tetelestai, because salvation's task, salvation's plan was finished. He was the Lamb slain in the mind of God from the foundation of the world. He was perfect. He was sinless. He was spotless. He was God's masterpiece. And when he said, it is finished, it didn't mean that he was finished. But thank God it meant salvation's plan was complete for everybody.
Before we leave the air today, we wanted to remind you about a very special free gift offer. The message you watch today is from a gift offer entitled Winterfest, and you'll receive three messages in their entirety from Winterfest, one from Calvin Ray Evans that we played on last week's broadcast entitled I'm Going to a Wedding, and then two from myself, The Power of Persuasion, and also the message that you watched today on The Man in the Middle. If you would like to receive these three sermons, they're available on DVD or audio CD. And you also receive bonus footage from Mike Blanton and Evidence, a tremendous singing group that we love to death that ministers with us. And you'll receive also some wonderful singing from them. Just contact us at 800-767-8713 or at calvinevans.org, or you can write to us at 299 Ohio Avenue, New Boston, Ohio, 45662. And also we wanted to remind you about the Come Alive Spring Camp Meeting coming up March the 20th through the 24th at the Shelby High School in Shelby, Ohio. Mike Blanton at Evidence will be there with us on Monday and Tuesday night. On Wednesday night, the Spencers, as well as the Camp Meeting Choir. On Thursday night, the Primitive Quartet. And on Friday night, the Glory Way Quartet, as well as the Tacketts. It's going to be a tremendous week there in Shelby, Ohio. Service time is 7 p.m. If you need more information, please contact us at 800-767-8713.
Thank you for joining us today on Evangelistic Outreach Ministries.
The fields are white, all ready to harvest.
For more information about this ministry, contact us at Evangelistic Outreach Ministries, 299 Ohio Avenue, New Boston, Ohio, 45662, or toll free at 800-767-8713. You can also visit us online at calvinevans.org.